In these short few months, we have learned a lot about ourselves and the coronavirus. A year from now, we're going to know much more. Scientists studying the enormous amounts of data we have at our disposal today are going to make each one of us smarter about our own health. My next guest, and this is very cool for me, and I'll get into that why, Dr. Catherine Ball is Chief Scientific Officer at Ancestry.com. It says Ancestry, but I'm going to say Ancestry.com. That's where you go. She has been leading a research study to understand the connection between our genes and COVID-19. Dr. Ball, I'm so excited to meet you. I'm an Ancestry.com addict, and we may be cousins, who knows. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm fascinated that Ancestry has launched a major COVID study as of April. Tell us about it.
Well, thank you. I'm really happy to be here. And Dr. Fauci hit the nail on the head. We're in this mess until we get a vaccine. And the question is, what are we going to do until we have a vaccine? And what are we going to do until we have a vaccine at enough abundance so everybody can use it? And so one of the things that we're doing at Ancestry is we're trying to find ways to identify those people who are most vulnerable. So we make sure that those people are armed with information that they need to take care of themselves and their families. So go ahead.
No, I was getting, I was going to say, tell us about the study. Yes.
Yeah. Let's step back. You know, Ancestry has a lot of terrific resources. One of the most important resources we have is some very engaged consumers. And we also have, as the leader in family history and consumer genomics, the largest database in the world with over 17 million genotyped individuals. And we also have a team of scientists. And when we were looking at this disease as it was playing out, and Dr. Fauci mentioned this too, you see some people who are completely asymptomatic and some people who have such terribly serious symptoms that it ends up in death. And that's very unusual for a pathogen. And so it really told us as a bunch of geneticists that there's probably a genetic reason why some people are more vulnerable to this disease than others. And so we have the resources and we started the study up to look at symptom severity, exposures, and susceptibility to this disease.
I know that you've already, in a very short period of time, found some differences, like gender disparities. Tell us about that.
So we did our very first initial study and found a link to susceptibility. So we basically looked at people who have been exposed to COVID-19 and compared those who, after exposure, became infected and those who did not. And found a single area in the genome close to a gene cunningly called IVNS1ABP. But it's basically a binding protein that's involved in influenza infection. And so it might be an interesting similar mechanism that the coronavirus is using. The other part is pretty notable, though, is that this part of the genome is involved in susceptibility only in men, but not women. And so that is intriguing because we've also observed, and a paper just came out in Nature from a group in England, that men do suffer more serious effects of infection with coronavirus. So this might be one clue about what's causing these disparities compared, you know, based on sex.
One of the questions that I've had in this is if we were having this discussion 15 years ago or 20 years ago, and we had not seen the advancements in genomic decoding. We had not seen how AI and all of these other tools had come on to sort of help advance science. We have the head of, you know, CEO of CRISPR coming on, for instance, shortly, and we'd be discussing this, where we would be right now. And I'd love you to kind of give our audience an understanding of how much this technological leap we've had in the last few years has changed what we're able to see.
I hate to think that we were doing this 20 years ago. That would be devastating, and I wouldn't mind an extra 20 years of science to get ahead of it. But the entire field of biomedical research has been just growing by leaps and bounds. The savings, cost savings we've been able to make just with genetic testing and genome sequencing over the last several years has been astonishing and has allowed us to accumulate a lot of data about people and also about pathogens and other diseases. And also, with this accumulation of data, has been some amazing and powerful machine learning and data science that's providing the kinds of insights that we could only have dreamed of when I was a spry little graduate student.
Well, one of the things that I wonder about, you know, how we take this information. So I get on Ancestry.com and I'm fascinated in it, but I'm also interested in the characteristics. And so I go and fill out all the forms and I'm waiting for, you know, some great insights about this. But on the preventative health side, do we have the right information sharing protocols out there? One of the questions is, in this world of data and personalized healthcare, as we look at everything coming together, do we need to change anything by way of how this is shared, creating greater permissibility? What does that infrastructure of information management need to look like so that we get more returns from it?
I think primarily we have to understand that the information that we need to create personalized preventative health insights are information about individuals. And so we do need to make sure that we are providing protection about that individual private information. So number one, I think that's very important. People know that their data are being held securely and their privacy is being respected. And that being said, with the study that we launched only in April, over 600,000 people have participated and shown, you know, their willingness to share both their genetics, but also details about their exposure and their symptoms. And we're even making those data available to other researchers around the world in universities or pharmaceutical companies or biotech companies. And people are willing to do that if they understand that they're making an impact, if they're creating value either for themselves or for their families, or in this case, for all of society. I think people are willing to make that sacrifice. But the very beginning and the very end, this needs to be about benefiting actual people in society rather than having an argument that this is benefiting a corporation.
Catherine, when you look at the folks that you have in your huge database, does it include all of us? One of the discussions that we've seen about COVID is that it really has exposed the fact that we have a lot of inequalities built in society. We have vulnerable communities, we have communities of color. When we look at clinical trials in science for like cancer research in Minnesota, there are huge efforts to try to get Native Americans, for instance, to participate, or Black Americans who try to participate when they made it. So do you have a platform that people aren't skeptical of, or are there still some communities out there that fear that kind of data platform?
Biomedical data science and clinical studies have been plagued for years with bias toward people of European descent. And I think it's rightfully getting a lot of attention in the last several years. And so, again, our platform is for consumers. So for almost anybody of long-time American descent or people who are interested in their genealogy, those are the people who are coming to us. We do have a fairly diverse set of individuals. That being said, I'm a scientist. I can always take more data. I would love it. But you're right, absolutely right. It is all of us as scientists need to really be paying attention to addressing all the different kinds of communities that we have in this country.
Let me just ask you finally, one of the intriguing questions I think is out there is right now we're very reactive to this virus, to understanding it, to treating it, to ending it and killing it, and doing all that needs to be. But there's also a lot of concern out there about the future waves of things that might hit us and hit us globally. As a data scientist, are there things that we should be proactively thinking about that we're not, that you would like to put on the table when it comes to thinking about the future and what we can do more of to anticipate or to be better prepared than we were with regards to this virus?
No matter what, like, we will take care of this. We will get through this. And then life will continue in a new normal. we will still have to worry about diabetes. We'll still have to worry about heart disease. We'll still have to worry about cancer. And so as a data scientist, what I'm trying to do is to make sure we use all these insights to let people know what are the most important things for them to address in partnership with their healthcare provider for them, so they can act early and act effectively to improve their health outcomes. And that's really what we're trying to do with Ancestry Health. And I think this is exactly the type of thing we're trying to do with this COVID study, to find those people who are most vulnerable and so that they can be treated appropriately by their healthcare providers. And I think this is a theme that we should be expecting to carry on in the years to come.
Well, Dr. Catherine Ball, it is a personal thrill of me to meet you virtually online like this and to talk about this important science. And we will remain very interested to see how this study proceeds and what you learn from it, and would love to share it with our viewers and readers at The Hill. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Steve. I look forward to updating you when we have more findings.